Presenting a case of a baby of Mrs. XYZ. The baby was born on 23rd April 2020 at 6 p.m. The age of the baby is 3 years. Gender is male. The baby resides in Hoskote. The LMP of the mother was 7th July 2019. The expected date of the delivery of the mother was 14th April 2020. The period of gestation of the mother was 38 weeks plus 2 days. The current weight of the baby is 2.98 kgs and the birth weight was 3 kgs. Place of delivery was MVJ Medical College and Research Hospital. The mode of delivery was a full-term normal vaginal delivery without instrumentation. Age of the mother at conception was 25 years and age of the mother at delivery was 26 years. The parity of the mother is para 1, living 1. Blood group is mother is B positive, the father is B positive, and the baby is also B positive. The informant is mother, and the reliability of the informant is good. Date of examination is 26th April 2020. Coming to the antenatal history, the first trimester, birth order is 1. UPT was done, the CBC was done, and thyroid function tests were done for the mother. The pregnancy was confirmed after 2 months of amenorrhea by ultrasonography. There was no fertility treatment that was taken for conception. There was no history of fever with rashes, excessive vomiting, fatigue, exposure to drugs or radiation, burning micturition, increased frequency of micturition, bleeding per vagina. Number of ANC visits in the first trimester was 2. The dating scan was done and folic acid was taken. Coming to the second trimester history. Quickening was at 5th month of gestation at about 20 weeks. Iron, calcium and folic acid supplements were taken. There was no history of headache, blurring of vision, giddiness, swelling of lower limbs that did not subside on rest, any fever with rashes, burning micturition, discharge or bleeding per vagina or pain abdomen. Oral glucose tolerance test was done and was normal. NT scan was done and was normal and fetal anomaly scan were done. Tetanus toxoid, 2 doses, 4 weeks apart were given to the mother. The number of ANC visits in the second trimester was 2. Coming to the third trimester, fetal movement was well perceived. No history of leaking or bleeding per vagina, pain abdomen, burning micturition, swelling in the lower limbs that did not subside on rest. There was no foul-smelling discharge or premature rupture of membranes. Iron and calcium supplements were taken. The growth scan was done. The number of ANC visits in the third trimester was 2. The total weight gain during pregnancy was 11.5 kg. Coming to the natal history, the LMP was 7th July 2019 and the expected date of delivery was 14th April 2020. The date of delivery was 24th April 2020. The place of delivery was MVJ Medical College and Research Hospital. It was a full-term normal vaginal delivery without instrumentation. Coming to the postnatal history, the gender of the baby is male, weight at birth was 3 kg, it cried immediately, there was no history of NICU admission, breastfeeding was initiated within half an hour of delivery, first urine and stools were passed after 5 hours of delivery, vitamin K supplementation of 1 mg IM was administered immediately after delivery. Chief complaints, the baby was brought for routine checkup with normal newborn care being provided and being evaluated for the same. Feeding history. Breastfeeding was initiated within half an hour of delivery. Number of times during the day was on demand and number of times during the night was 3. There was no supplementary feeding. The baby used to pass urine around 6 times and stool 5 times. Sleeps 2 to 3 hours after feeding. Immunization history. BCG was given at birth. OPV was given at birth. Hepatitis B was given at birth and immunized till date. Maternal history, past obstetric history of the mother, married since 3 years, no consanguineous marriage, no history of treatment for infertility, no history of abortions, number of children is 1, no significant past history or treatment history for the mother. Coming to the family history, there's no history of hemolytic disease, liver disease, disease of gallbladder, any hereditary diseases in the family. Personal history, diet, breast milk, sleep adequate, bowel and bladder movement is normal. socioeconomic status, belongs to class 4 of modified BG Prasad classification, lives in a pakka house, no overcrowding present. Summary: a 3-day-old term baby boy belonging to the socioeconomic status class 4 modified BG Prasad, who is exclusively breastfed and immunized till date, born to non-consanguineous parents by marriage, by normal vaginal delivery without instrumentation. The pregnancy was uneventful, with normal growth and non-significant past and family history, came for regular checkup and was provided with normal newborn care and was evaluated for the same. General physical examination. Date of examination is 26th April 2020. Posture and attitude. Ventral, complete lack of head control. Straight back with elbows and knees flexed and slight extension at hip. Prone, head turned to one side, pelvis is high. Supine, asymmetric tonic neck reflex is present. When pulled to sit, complete head lag present. Normal activity. Vitals, temperatures 98 degrees Fahrenheit, airway normal, respiratory rate 42 cycles per minute and is thoraco-abdominal, heart rate 142 beats per minute and blood pressure 62/40 mmHg, capillary refilling time 2 seconds, pulses were felt and were regular, there is no radio-radial or radio-femoral delay. Anthropometry, birth weight was 3 kgs and weight at examination was 2.98 kgs. Length 53 cm, head circumference 34 cm, chest circumference 32.5 cm, and ponderal index was 2. All the anthropometrical values are in the 50th centile. Head to toe examination. Head normal, molding not present, caput succedaneum not present, cephal hematoma not present, normal anterior and posterior fontanelles, no bruises present, face normal, no dysmorphic facies, eyes normal, ears normal in size and shape, elastic recoil present, nose normal, milia are present, oral cavity and contents normal, skin vernix caseosa present, erythema neonatorum present, Langvo present, chest normal, umbilical cord and umbilicus, central stump healing and no discharge seen, genital penis normal, testis palpable, back normal, extremities, limbs, palms, soles and digits all were normal. There was no pallor or icterus present. All the orifices are present and are patent. Pallor absent, icterus absent, clubbing absent, cyanosis absent, lymphadenopathy, lymph nodes not palpable, edema absent, capillary refilling time approximately 2 seconds. Coming to the systemic examination, abdominal and genital examination. Inspection, abdomen was non-distended. Umbilicus was central. Umbilical stump was showed healing and no discharge was seen. Corresponding quadrants moved equally with respiration. There were no dilated veins or scars. Hernial orifices were normal. Genitalia were normal. On palpation, there was no local rise in temperature. No tenderness. No palpable mass. Percussion, no organomegaly. Auscultation, vowel sounds were heard. Cardiovascular examination, S1 and S2 were heard. Respiratory examination, normal vesicular breath sounds were heard, bilateral equal air entry. Central nervous system examination, higher mental functions normal for age, reflexes, rooting reflex is present, sucking reflex is present, Moro's reflex is present, asymmetric tonic neck reflex is present, and palmar grasp reflex is present. Musculoskeletal examination, no abnormalities were detected. Diagnosis, the baby was found to be normal on examination. Yes.
Now go back to first slide.
Yes, sir.
Can you go back to the first slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Congrats, Shravan. You have done a very good presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Let's look at how we can do it even better, or probably as all of you saw that most of you all, I just want to emphasize the fact that for MBBS exam, one of the case was most likely would be newborn. And therefore, all of you all should be perfect with the history taking examination and also be ready with the answers for the questions which are going to be asked. So it's an easily you were the a case where you can score well and you can do really well. And I think at the end of this webinar, most of you all would be in a position to answer most of the questions, to know how to present it very clearly. He has shown you the format. I'm just going to just try to make it more lucid and try to cut short whatever is not required. Okay. So probably, I think, I'm not sure whether I have to ask questions and then they can answer, or you, shall I just continue?
Ask, so you can ask questions.
Yes, sir. You ask, sir, they will be answering the chat section, sir. Okay. Shravan will be answering you directly, orally. Others will be answering you and asking doubts in the chat section, sir. Please, you should be seeing the chat section also.
Yeah. Okay. So as of now, let us go through the history, how Shravan presented. Now we have, you have to, all of you all have to understand that in examination, you will have maximum of around 10 minutes to 15 minutes to present. So therefore, you all should have a very crisp presentation. That means whatever is really required, that information should be given to the examiner. And we are not in a position to take any extra information. So as you saw in Shravan's presentation, that many times, many things were repeated. So therefore, what I will just tell you now in the next 5 minutes or so is just an outline of what exactly should be we require when you start off with presentation, what is required in the antenatal history, what is required in the natal history, what is required in the postnatal history, and then I'll go through the questions which are going to be asked at each level. Okay. So now when you start off with presentation, you can say baby of with the name, as because you are saying that it is from born to a non-consanguineous or consanguineous marriage to a 20-year-old primie. So instead of telling the name of thing, date of birth, age, gender, all that, you can just put it in one sentence and make it like a story. So you just open up. It becomes very interesting for the examiner also to listen. So you can just say, for example, baby of Mrs. or you can say baby of thing. Born or on 23rd, 23-day-old, born to a non-consanguineous marriage through normal vaginal delivery or term gestation with a birth weight of 2.3. You can just finish off with that one line, which gives you a whole lot of information residing at which area. Okay. And also you can also tell that the baby is for routine postnatal care. So baby is waiting here for routine postnatal care or feed establishment. Suppose he's come out from NICU, you can say as a step down care from NICU is waiting here. Or sometimes in LSCS mothers, you may be waiting for the maternal discharge. So you can say for routine normal care, newborn care, as well as waiting for maternal discharge. So that completes your opening statement. So I don't want you to put it like age, gender, address, like that. You know, don't do that. Of course, it's for writing and presentation of the slide, it's okay. But when you're presenting it to some on the exam, so you just saw that it just took maybe around 10 seconds for me to tell, give us the demographic data. Of course, whatever he has included, it's fine. So there itself, you can say the age of the mother, consanguinity, tell which order, birth order, tell the birth weight, date of birth, and today, what is the day of life? That's what you're going to, I would like to add on the first information, whatever he has told. Can you go to the next slide? Yeah, so that whole thing will be covered in whatever I told you. All this is, and again, so born by what delivery? When we say that it is normal vaginal delivery, it is understood that it is without instrumentation. So you need not stress on that saying that there's no instrumentation. So just make it very, very simple and so that it can be understood easily, and you finish it off within, like for example, 5 seconds, the first opening statement should be over. Antenatal history wise, so whatever he has told you is fine, but just for you all to just remember in the exam what is going to be presented in the antenatal history, you just need to just remember that we need to know the first trimester history. We are worried about what are the problems which can affect the fetus during the period of organogenesis. So that is, all of you all know that it is infection, drugs and radiation, so IDR. So that's the only three things which you have to ask. We want you really, please don't mention the status that pregnancy was confirmed by UPT, all that is not required. Okay, so what is really required? Just be very precise to the point. That's what we're waiting to hear. Give more time for discussion so that your points will be very clear. You get some examination questions to answer and impress the examiner. So you just, in the first trimester, I just want to know whether it was booked or booked case and how many antenatal visits she has received. And in the first trimester, I just want to know that her, what are the specific history is? Is there infection history? And is infection suggestive of an intrauterine infection? Now, what are the questions should we ask for intrauterine infections? Now, we all know that intrauterine infections are classified or grouped under a term called torches. Now it is called torches clap. So you want specific history which is required for infection. That is, you're going to ask for fever with rash and lymphadenopathy. So what is more important is fever with rash and lymphadenopathy, because mothers may not be telling you about fever because it's a low grade fever. They may not be able to notice the rash, but something which you cannot mix, especially in toxoplasmosis and rubella, is a lymphadenopathy. So you're going to ask for fever with rash and lymphadenopathy. So that is for your history of infection. Then when we look at infection related to drugs, you need to know which are the drugs which are going to affect organogenesis and some of the characteristic syndromes. So for example, alcohol, fetal alcohol syndrome. So baby is taking phenytoin, fetal hydantoin syndrome. So baby is taking, my mother is taking lithium. So you're going to have Epstein's anomaly. So you're going to have specific drugs, a list of the drugs and the list of the anomalies which is going to be caused. So you should be ready for the questions there. And then, of course, radiation. As all of you all know, that radiation can cause history of chromosomal aberration. So you need to know history of, again, I repeat, infection. Why? That is the dating scan. So all of you all know that the dating scan is the most approximate if it is done in the first trimester, which gives you an approximate.
Sir, rightly pointed out. It's been, as of now, a good case presentation. So I will go to the second slide. Third slide. Yeah. What sir was telling that being precise to 3 points in antenatal history, that is infection, drugs, and radiation exposure. So in first trimester, what happens is there will be organogenesis which will be hampered by these three events. We all know, as sir was mentioning, the drugs which all cause impairment in organogenesis, such as fetal hydantoin syndrome, fetal alcohol syndrome, and Epstein's anomalies. In case of phenytoin, alcohol, and lithium respectively. Some other drugs are also important, such as valproate, which cause cleft lip and cleft palate. Most of these drugs are basically antiepileptics or sulfonamides. Okay, then. Regarding folic acid, any recommendation we have that you know of?
Shravan, you can answer. Shravan?
Not sure, sir.
Okay. As of now, 400 milligram, we'll say the chat section, or there are answers there. Okay. Yeah. 400 milligram before conception, 3 months. Is the raised dosage. This is if the sibling was having neural tube defects, then you use 4 mg. Those tablets doesn't come, so you give 5 mg. Okay. Coming to the next slide. Second slide. Yeah. in the second trimester, what all the events of the pregnancy that affect the mother? Shravan?
Sir, quickening.
Yes. What will you gain by answering, what will you gain by asking about quickening?
Sir, that fetal development is going correctly. And
okay, Ashta, do you have any answers? Or our participants can answer also. Quickening, what is the importance of quickening? Ashta is not there. Or where is our Anand? Yes, live fetus. And we also come to know about in this point we will read something about fetal monitoring. Okay, and quickening as a part is one of the component of fetal monitoring. Okay, actually a strict fetal monitoring is not being followed, but to some extent fetal monitoring should be done, and quickening is one of the methods. I mean, quickening and fetal movement monitoring can be observed. And also quickening, delayed in quickening is one of the early markers of a disease called spinomuscular atrophy. Okay, obviously there are other diseases such as fetal distress, which cause hypoxia and brain damage, which also reduces quickening. And regarding iron, calcium and folic acid has been sir.
So is it audible clearly now?
Yes sir. You can go on, sir. It is audible.
Yes sir.
Okay, fine. So as I was telling you, the first trimester we are just worried about infection, drug, radiation, and I was just could just hear the saying that how much folic acid to be given, that's very important. So you need to know that we need to give at least 400 micrograms and 4 milligrams. These are the two magic numbers you can give. You can say 4 or 5. So you can remember 400 is for prevention, 5 milligrams or 4 milligrams and 400 micrograms. 400 micrograms is for prevention, whereas 4 milligrams is for when you have already a baby with neural tube defects. If you want to prevent it, it has to be started for the second pregnancy. If you want to take, you're going to start about a month prior to the conception. When they're deciding to have the baby, they're going to continue and continue throughout pregnancy is what is the recommended folic. So that's another common question which is going to be asked about how much folic acid you're going to start for prevention and how much you're going to start for a mother who already has the baby with for the second pregnancy. If you want to advise to prevent neural tube defects, that's what you're going to do it. Fine. Next, I'll just give you a list of the drugs and the anomalies when, as time permits at the end of the session. So coming to the second trimester, since you already were in the second trimester, so I'll just continue from there. In second trimester, how do we remember what is the the history required? Is you're going to say the disorders which are going to affect pregnancy. So there I said disorders affecting organogenesis. Here, maternal disorders complicating pregnancy. So you're going to say, so what Shravan did was he described about the symptoms required, like for example swelling, headache, all that is going to take time. So you can straight away say that history suggestive of PIH, history of diabetes, so you can say meal, which is maternal, chronic maternal illnesses, like for example she has a heart disease or she has a chronic asthma or she had tuberculosis. So chronic maternal his medical history. And if she has no significant chronic maternal history and there's no history suggestive of PIH and diabetes, that should be enough for you to tell in the second trimester. And second trimester is important whether she has started off an iron and folic acid, a TT status. And then you're going to also tell us that in the second trimester, anomaly scan. So you saw in the first trimester, it is IDR plus one scan. Again here, history of maternal illnesses complicating pregnancy, chronic medical diseases of the pregnancy, which is affecting, which can alter, because as you know that volume status increases, so all these disorders are going to complicate in second trimester. And second trimester, we want to know about the one scan, which is about the most important, is the anomaly scan, usually done around 18 to 22 weeks. Most of the anomalies you're going to make out, except for some outflow tract anomalies of cardiac disease. You're not trimester, you're going to ask for dating scan and one scan. Screening for Down syndrome. So screening for chromosome anomalies, that is Down syndrome. So NT scan, you want to look at second trimester, you're going to look at anomaly scan. You're going to look at also ask for quickening, as somebody was saying, quickening is important. So you know that it starts off at around 16 to 18 weeks. So you can 18 weeks, that is important, as already was discussed, that some of, suppose if the baby is not moving because of a congenital myopathy or a SMA, for example, then you know that there could be decreased fetal movement. That's the importance of asking fetal movement history. So you're going to ask for, just to revise in second trimester, medical history, PIH diabetes, one scan, iron folic acid, TT, and then you're going to ask for quickening history. That's all we need in the second trimester history. Third trimester history, we are looking at events complicating delivery. So events complicating delivery, that's all. So you're going to say that whether she had any kind of leaking PV, whether she had premature rupture of membranes, whether she had bleeding PV, pain abdomen, and what's happening prior to delivery. That means we want to know risk factors for sepsis. That's what we want to know. Risk factors for complication, whether she had prolonged labor. So prolonged means rupture of membranes, whether she had leaking PV, all that which is going to affect the onset, which is going to give you problems as an early delivery, premature delivery, or risk factors for early onset sepsis. That's what we're worried. And then we want to know whether her total weight gain, that's what we want to know, is the weight gain in pregnancy. So that gives us a rough idea of how the baby is growing in utero. So that's what we want to know in the third trimester. So whether she has visited, and usually they monitor them. Suppose if it's a complicated pregnancy, they do something called as biophysical profile. If she knows, well and good. Otherwise, it's not required. So if you say if she herself had biophysical profile, that is biweekly NST with AFI. That means you want to know the Leica volume. So that's what you all. That's all what is required in the third trimester history. Okay, so in the first trimester, you're going to ask, you maybe ask questions on what I told you, that is intrauterine infection, drugs, and then you're going to ask history of folic acid supplementation. Second trimester history, they may ask you, how do you think PIH is going to affect the baby? So all of you know that PIH is going to cause an abnormal placentation. That means blood supply is low, so therefore the baby can be born small for gestation age or an IUGR baby. Similarly, sometimes a question can be asked on how can diabetes affect baby and what are the features of infant of diabetic mother. So that's how you're going to prepare your answers for. So you're going to ask how a small for this, how PIH affects the baby, how diabetes affects the baby. Just know some salient features of infant of diabetic mother. So you just know how the infant of diabetic mother, all of you know that infant of diabetic mother looks large for gestation age. Usually they're big babies, they have cherubic faces, they have moon-like faces, the buffalo hump because of fat deposition. Then you're going to say they're going to be plethoric because they're going to be polycythemic. And then you know they can be specific anomalies for the diabetes. So you know that they're more prone for congenital heart disease, especially the specific anomaly you can say is TGA, whereas the most common is asymmetrical septal hypertrophy. And then you can see that they are more prone for jaundice, they are more prone for some mural tube defects, as well as anencephaly, the neurological defects. So the specific anomaly is caudal regression syndrome. So some specific anomalies you're going to note down for infant of diabetic mother, specific features.
Sir, one request. One request. Can you please go a little slower and please stress upon and repeat the important ones, sir, please, for a kind request for from our members. We'll go a little slower. And please repeat the important ones, please.
Okay, fine. I was just going faster because I thought already it was discussed. So
no, sir.
Okay, fine. So you want me to start off from the first trimester again?
No. Third trimester will continue, sir. Third trimester.
Okay. So in third trimester, as I was saying, we are worried about what's going to affect, which can cause early delivery or which can have an effect on delivery. That is, you said that is it's leak PV or pain abdomen, or you can say bleeding PV or prolonged rupture of membranes or premature pregnancy. So that's what we're going to be worried. There, you're going to really know about the Leica volume, and some pregnancies which are complicated, they try to monitor the pregnancy by doing something called as biophysical profile. So if they know it, you can tell it. That is called as modified biophysical profile is what we do, where we do a biweekly NST as well as AFI, amniotic fluid index. So we want to know how the volume is. So amniotic fluid index. And then when we want to know also regarding the weight gain in pregnancy. Whatever you're seeing on the slide, weight gain in pregnancy is what we know. And all of you know, they're going to ask you what is the average weight gain of Indian women. So you can see around 11 kgs. So when you know that the mother has not gained weight, then you know probably the fetus is not growing well. And the second thing which I was asking is, telling you all is, how the another question which they're going to ask you is, how do you think the maternal illnesses are going to affect the baby? For example, you're going to know that, for example, like PIH is, you're going to get a small for gestational IUGR baby. Similarly, diabetes is going to ask, it's going to cause a large for gestational age baby, and you have to know the features of an infant of diabetic mother. So you're going to note down from your books, what are the features of infant of diabetic mother? As I told you, some of them, they're usually large for gestational age. They're going to be plethoric because they're going to be polycythemic. And then, you know, they are going to have specific cardiovascular anomalies, specific neurological anomalies. Specific cardiac anomaly is TGA, TGV, transposition of great vessels. And then the specific neurological anomaly is caudal regression syndrome. But the most common anomaly in cardiac, if you see, is asymmetrical septal hypertrophy. And sometimes they're going to ask you what metabolic complications do you expect in infant of diabetic mother, that is hypoglycemia, hypocalcemia, and they're more prone for jaundice. I think this much, if you know, for IDM is quite more than sufficient. Fine. So this is what is required in the first trimester, second trimester, and third trimester history. That's all. Just so be very specific and important points you're going to take down, what you're going to ask. And you're going to write down the questions also, which can be asked at history level. Okay. Now coming to postnatal history. So you're going to say baby was born by, what is the mode of delivery? Already you have told that he was born on this date. You can just say mode of delivery. And you can also tell us place already yourself. So you need not tell us about the place of delivery again. You have already told normal. So you need not say that there's no instrumentation. You can just say born by normal vaginal delivery, or you say LSCS. You mention the indication, which just tells us that there is a risk factor, the risk factor for sepsis, or there is a risk factor that for something called as birth asphyxia. When a baby does not transit well, when the baby does not cry immediately after birth, all of you know that condition is called birth asphyxia. So we want to know whether there was a prolonged labor, whether there was instrumentation delivery, whether there was meconium stained lacquer, or whether there was, my mother was, what is the total duration of from the pain onset of pain and when she delivered. So you want to know whether there are risk factors for birth asphyxia. That's the main reason why you want to know the mode of delivery and how the how she has progressed, whether she has progressed fast. And here sometimes you may have to know the duration of labor. So what is prolonged labor? So prolonged labor is something when the first and second stage inclusive is more than 24 hours, you say it is as prolonged labor. Okay, so prolonged labor, instrumentation delivery, whether instrumentation was done, meconium stain lacquer, and you want to know the mode of delivery and the indication. If it's a cesarean section, you want to know the indication of delivery. That's all is required in datal history. Okay. Next. So when you look at birth history, that means the postnatal history. So you would always know whether he has transited well. So you're going to say the baby cried immediately after birth, or he required any resuscitation. That means to help him breathe. If he did not cry at birth, you know that he's going to be helped. So if she knows that, okay, they did some resuscitation, they did some help, they did, then baby did not cry, and therefore he was helped to breathe. So you can ask for resuscitation. At this point of time, they may ask you about what you mean by Apgar score. So what is Apgar score? All of you should know at least the components and how. It's also a theory question. So you're going to write down what is Apgar score. All of you know Apgar is, A is for appearance, and P is
pulse.
The pulse rate, isn't it? And G is for
grimace,
and A is for activity, and then you know that R is for reflexes. Okay, so the grimace is whether when the baby is how the baby is actually moving, how, whether you have any stimulation when you do with the nasopharyngeal tube, whether he has a normal reflex or he coughs out. So that's, you have 0, 1, 2 score. So I think you should know Apgar scoring, the components of Apgar. So you know that it is appearance, that is mainly the color you want to know, whether it is color, is there peripheral cyanosis, acrocyanosis, or complete cyanosis is there. And then you want to know about the pulse rate, whether it is less than 100, more than 100, that's how you know it is 0, 1, 2 score. You want to know the reflexes, your grimace activity, and then you want to know the reflexes that you want to know whether it's a weak cry respiration. R, last R is respiration. So you want to know whether the baby has a weak cry or he has a strong cry. So that he already did not cry. When he did not cry, it will be zero score. So all of you can make a chart of what is Apgar score and know about. So that components will know. And sometimes they may ask you the steps of resuscitation. So because it's a short time, I'm not going to go through that. You can just go through the algorithm for when the baby does not cry immediately after birth, what are the steps of resuscitation? So that's what you need to know in the postnatal history. And in the postnatal history, most important is after that, when was breastfeeding initiated? So most commonly, you're going to get all questions on breastfeeding at this level. You're going to ask for when was breastfeeding, as of all of you know, that breastfeeding should be initiated as early as possible. So there's no limit, like you say, half an hour or 1 hour in the cesarean section. So it's as early as possible. In LSCS, it is as soon as anesthesia starts wearing off, you're going to put on the breast. And you know that as early as possible you feed, because the baby and mother are tired at the end of delivery, both of them go to sleep. So obviously you're going to feed the baby as early as possible, and the baby is its neurological best in the first 1 hour of life. And that's why then most important, so that you have bonding and sustainability of breastfeeding is there. So as early as possible, you're going to breastfeed. And all of you all know, you're going to also ask for history of adequacy of feeding. So very important to know the adequacy of feeding here. So how do we know that the baby is feeding adequately? So you have something called as subjective criteria and objective criteria. Subjective criteria is which you're going to ask for mother to see how the breastfeeding is adequate. And you have some objective criteria where you can measure from the mother, right? So you can say subjective criteria is where you're going to ask the mother, saying that the baby is going to, is the baby feeding and sleeping? So sleep, you're going to ask for sleep. You're going to ask for urine output. So these are two things which you're going to ask the mother. Is he sleeping 1 to 2 hours post feeds? Then you know probably the breast milk is adequate. And then you're going to ask for whether the baby is passing urine around 6 to 8 times urine and one golden yellow stool. So that's what tell you roughly there is. And one more subjective feeling is when she's feeding on one side, the other side she's having dribbling of milk. So this tells us that the breast milk is adequate. And when you objectively measure, you need the weight gain. All of you know, in the first 10 days of life, all babies are going to lose about 10% of their birth weight. So 1 to 2% in a term baby, in a preterm baby, they can use or lose up to 10 to 15% birth weight. So you may have to know how much weight they're going to lose. So very important to know also this at this level to tell us the birth weight. And in the postnatal history, what is his birth weight today? So what is the weight on the day of examination and whether there is weight loss? You're going to calculate the percentage of weight loss. So that will tell us whether the feeding has been adequate. Okay. And all of you know what is the time when we pass urine? Within 24 hours, you know that they should have passed stools. Stools should be passed within 24 hours. And urine, you can wait for 48 hours. So 48 hours, you can wait for urine. Whereas two should be passed within the first 24 hours. If they don't pass within the first 24 hours, you have to find out what is the reason why they have not passed stools, right? So it's not normal. Vitamin K, if she knows that vitamin 1 injection was given immediately after delivery, you can say vitamin K. Otherwise, probably that history you may not get in all patients. So that's about the postnatal history, what you're going to ask, what is really needed. So postnatal history, we want to know about when breastfeeding was started. And then we want to know about problem in the transition, was there any difficulty in breathing, or baby did not transit well, he was shifted to an ICU, and then something was some activity. You may not know everything, you may just seen and for 2 days, and then he was kept for support, put with oxygen. What day the feeding was started is very important, whether it was OG feed or it is NG feed. Then we know what kind of, what is the baby transited well, is was he baby who's having birth asphyxia, could not feed the first 2 days, that's why he was very sick because of distress. So some brief idea you just need to give us what has happened in the NICU, and you say that he was shifted out on that day, now he's waiting for completion of antibiotics, or he had some infection. They would have told in the NICU, so mother may be aware what has happened, some rough clue of what has happened. But definitely if there is jaundice, you need to expand the jaundice history. You need to expand the history, what you ask for. If the particular complaint is for jaundice, you're going to explain the jaundice complaint. But otherwise, you can just put it in mother's words and say specific reason why he was admitted in NICU, and then you can come back and say that this is the reason why he was there in the NICU, and then you can just roughly you can tell that this may be the cause, like sepsis may be the cause, or did he had respiratory distress, so this may be the cause. If there was a meconium stain, like he may have meconium aspiration syndrome, so there may be a rough idea. So they may ask you, why, what do you think the problem was? Is it because of prematurity, or is it because of low birth weight, or is it because of some reason why he was shipped to NICU? You should be able to explain the postnatal history. Fine. So then when we come to the chief complaints, so ideally there is nothing like chief complaint. You just need to say why the baby is here. Now, why the baby is here? Usually you know that it is for routine care. So most of the baby routine postnatal care. And you know that in normal deliveries, usually we wait for 3 days because we know that onset of jaundice is going to happen after 3 days, when because you know that jaundice peaks, it starts off with 3 days, and you know that it peaks by 5 to 7 days and then comes down by 7 to 10 days. So therefore most of them will at least keep the babies for 3 days. And of course section babies, sometimes they may discharge on day 3 or day 5, depends on hospital. So you can just tell why the patient is there. But if the patient has jaundice, we expect you to ask a little more detailed history, because one of the common case you're going to get in the exam is a normal neonate. That means without no complications, no problems, no things. So you can write down all this. You just say he's for postnatal care, waiting for feed establishment, waiting for maternal discharge. That's all. Okay. Whereas suppose if he's in a if he's having jaundice, you're going to expand the jaundice history. Whereas all others, I told you, you can just say what is the reason for he was there in the NICU and he's been shifted here. Now he's waiting for discharge. So this is how you're going to answer what the chief complaint is. But if it is jaundice, let's see how to expand the jaundice history. Now I'm going to tell you, as any symptom or any history, even in pediatrics, you know that you're going to expand in the terms of onset, progression, duration, etiology and complication. You know that OPDEC sequence. So you're going to say when the jaundice started, when the mother noticed, and then you know when, how it has progressed, what is the duration, you know what is the etiology. You need to get some questions to find out what is could be the etiology and what are the complications the jaundice can do to the baby. So that's how you're going to complete the history. If at all you say that the yellowish discoloration was noted and you say that the baby was treated for phototherapy, either it could be in the ward or it in the NICU, you have to expand the history a little more. Now let's see how to do it. So first and foremost, you're going to look at, you say that mother noticed yellowish discoloration on which day of life. All of you all know that we need to distinguish between physiological jaundice and pathological jaundice. And that's the reason why we need to know when was the onset of jaundice. The onset of jaundice is either on day 1 or whether it was on day 2, day 3. And then when was phototherapy given, for how many days? And then now he is off phototherapy. That's what you want to know. So onset, progression, he might know that initially we saw it on the face, then by the next day we saw it in the soles, and then we saw then phototherapy was given or a blood test was done. She may also know the levels. So you can just say what blood test was done and started on phototherapy. So onset, progression, duration, you know, and then we know to know why the jaundice came. So for which we should know a mnemonic called jaundice, J-A-U-N-D-I-C-E. So that means I have to fit why this baby got jaundice. If I want to find out why this baby got jaundice, I have to answer these questions. Now, that is J is jaundice within the first 24 hours. If I want to know jaundice within the first 24 hours, definitely I know that it is a pathological jaundice. So jaundice within first 24 hours is definitely pathological. So you want to know when the jaundice came. A is Asian range, whether she belongs to Asian range. All of us are in Asian, so we are at risk for jaundice. U is under 37 weeks. So under 37 weeks, are all preterm babies are at risk for jaundice. So you know that under 37 weeks, you are at risk for jaundice. So if it's a preterm baby, there is more risk or more chances of jaundice. So you want to know the gestation of the baby. So J-A-U-N is for nursing. So you want to know whether breastfeeding jaundice or it is a breast milk jaundice. So nursing is breastfeeding or breast milk jaundice. When we say breast feeding jaundice, most likely because of inadequate milk to the baby has got jaundice. So therefore, you're going to already have asked that about the feeding history. So you can just say feeding is not adequate by the questions which I told you. There are some subjective and objective criteria. And you also know that you can also tell us about the weight. Since there is so much weight loss, probably inadequate feeding or breastfeeding jaundice or dehydration is the cause for the jaundice. So, but breast milk jaundice, as of all of you all know, that is going to act or start off only in the second week. Most of our babies would have gone by then. So most likely it may not be, and the baby will be gaining weight. There's no other problem, only jaundice. So that is what is called as breast milk jaundice. And it's because of inhibitory substances in the breast milk, which is going to cause jaundice. So that is breast milk jaundice. So then we need to know that is about N. So then D is for deficiency. Already you have asked for a family, you'll be asking about a family history. So family history, you're going to ask for any person with previous jaundice or exchange transfusion, phototherapy given, or that there is any hemolytic suggestive of a deficiency of enzyme. So I is incompatibility. Therefore, in any jaundice baby, you're going to ask for blood group of the mother. Blood group of the mother, blood group of the father. If the mother is negative group and the father is positive group, you know that there could be a possibility of Rh incompatibility. So at the end, when you write the diagnosis, you will say that, okay, Rh, there may be, the baby has jaundice. So this is the reason, there may be Rh setup is there. Mother is negative, father is positive. If you know the blood group of the baby, you can also say that probably if the baby is positive, there is a chance of Rh incompatibility. Another blood group setup, which is important at history level, is if mother is O, baby is A or B, there could be a possibility of ABO incompatibility. So you're going to say about AB, blood group of the mother and baby is very important at that point of level to look at incompatibility. C is for cephalhematoma. So you can say there's no obvious swellings in the scalp. So there's no obvious swellings. So there, because you know cephalhematoma could be a risk factor for jaundice. And E is elder sibling receiving phototherapy. So if elder sibling has received phototherapy, you know that there's more risk for jaundice. So the, when you ask for history of jaundice, you're going to ask for these specific history. So specific history is history for which onset of day of life the jaundice came. You want to know about whether it is means A is for Asian range, which is a term or preterm. You want to know history of any deficiency of like G6PD or any family history. So then you want to know incompatibility, so you know blood group, you know N is for nursing. So you need whether it is a breast milk jaundice or breastfeeding jaundice, and C is any cephalhemata causing the jaundice, and E is if elder sibling has received jaundice. And then that's for the risk factors to know why the baby has got jaundice. And as I told you, that is for etiology question of your history. And then the next reason why you want to know is the complications. What the complications of jaundice can do to the baby. So you know that baby, when he presents in the newborn period, he presents to you with acute bilirubin encephalopathy. So when he presents with acute bilirubin encephalopathy, he'll come to you with some symptoms. If the bilirubin has entered the brain and causing symptoms, he can come to you with acute bilirubin encephalopathy. Now, what is the history you're going to take for that? You're going to take history of poor feeding, lethargy, seizures. So these are the three history which you're going to say if the jaundice is affecting the baby. That is a complication which the jaundice has caused to the baby, right? So this is in nutshell how you're going to expand the history for jaundice. And now if you get a jaundice case in the exam, so right away before examination itself, they may be asking you questions on how do you distinguish between physiological jaundice? What is the differences between physiological jaundice and pathological jaundice? What is the treatment for jaundice? What is phototherapy? And what are the complications of phototherapy? What is exchange transfusion? And what is the other available treatments for jaundice? So these questions you have to be ready to answer at the jaundice level. Okay, so if at all you say that the chief complaint is yellowish discolor, because most of you will be getting a baby with jaundice. So that's why I've expanded what history we need, extra history we need for a jaundice baby. And then if time permits, we'll go through these questions at the end of it. Yeah. So the next, once you have come to that, I think feeding history, all this have been already told in the postnatal history. So probably all this would have covered in the, we expect you to tell us in the postnatal history itself. Immunization history, you're going to tell us about the immunized, all of you know that BCG, hepatitis B, and polio drops have been given at birth. So you know that as early as possible, you're going to give hepatitis B. Of course, BCG may be variable. They may be giving you before discharge. So that's what you're going. You need not say immunized till date. You can just say immunization given, not given. That's all. And what BCG, hepatitis, OPV is given. That's it. That's all you're going to tell. Yeah. Next. I think we need not tell again about the maternal history here, which you have already told. That's why I said you start off the opening statement that may be born to a consanguineous, non-consanguineous, primi gravida, or if she is para 2. So that itself will give you significant history. So you need not really tell us about maternal history specifically, because I just want, this is all what, as I told you, the history should be very crisp, and you should just go to right away to the examination at the end of it. Yeah, family history, if it is really significant, you tell. Otherwise, there is no specific thing, unless you have a previous sibling which is affected, or there is a significant history, you mention. Otherwise, I think whatever is covered is fine. Hemolytic disease, early newborn death, so early neonatal death, if there is significant in the history, you would have already told at the opening statement itself. So you can just add on that. To that, if there is significant, suppose neonatal death is there, or if the mother had recurrent abortions, if the mother has had any family history of any specific anomaly, it is there, you tell. Otherwise, I don't think you need to give much importance to it. Yeah. Next. Yeah. Again, personal history, I don't think you should put an element of personal history. So I don't think personal history you need to write at all. You have already told that there is breast milk was started, what, how you have found out how adequacy of breast milk. I told you how to say that the breast milk is adequate or not. I don't think this is required. You have told already stool and urine, so I don't think personal history is required there. You will also tell us about socioeconomic status. I think Kupasomi scale, that you need to tell Paka house, no crowding, all that is not required. You just say socioeconomic status, just put one line, that's all is enough. Suppose you're presenting for the other pediatric case, it's much important, but in socioeconomic status, just say modify how well she takes care of the baby, that's what we need to know, her literacy level, and that's all. So just say the class, and that should be enough. Okay, fine. Next. So then you have to summarize at the end of history. So if it is a summary, again, whatever he has summarized is fine. So 3-day old, belonging to socioeconomic status is really not a matter. You can just say whether it is consanguinity is important here. So meanwhile, you may be, I didn't tell you at the consanguinity level itself, you may be having questions on consanguinity level. Just one question, what they commonly ask is, what are the degrees of consanguinity? So all of you know that they could be first degree consanguinity, second degree, and third degree. Correct? So first degree, you know it is father, daughter, mother, son, incest, first degree. Second degree, you know it is uncle, aunt. Okay. Third degree, you know it is cousins. Okay. So that's how you're going to look at, and the amount of genetic material will be 50%, 25%, half. So you know how much genetic material they're going to share. Only one point I want to emphasize is that you know that second degree, if there is a second degree consanguinity, there's increased chances of autosomal recessive condition. Okay. And some examples of autosomal dominant, autosomal recessive, X-link recessive, X-link dominant, 2-3 conditions you should be noting down and keeping it ready in case the child, if genetics level, you'll be asked this, and the pedigree chart. If you can do that much, I think genetics part will be covered. So in any case history, suppose these are the questions which can be asked. So you're going to ask, you should know the degrees of consanguinity. You should also tell us about what is the risk of next pregnancy, if it is an autosomal recessive disorder, if it's an autosomal, what are the some of the examples of autosomal dominant, recessive, and X-linked recessive and X-linked dominant. So this much, if you know some examples, that should be enough. So you say only about consanguinity, and you tell who has mode of delivery. You're going to tell the after mode of delivery. You say if they had any postnatal complications, that means he cried immediately after birth, had a normal transition, that means he did not have any distress, he was not shifted to NICU, so he had a normal transition, you can put it, and then he was shifted to the who had a normal transition and who was established breastfeed, who's waiting for routine postnatal care, and he's been waiting for maternal discharge or before feed establishment. That's all we require here. So when you say normal vaginal delivery, it's assumed that there is no instrumentation. So you can just say, and I told with no significant family history. I think if you just mention that you're just asking for more questions. So you can just say that it is a term, or you have to mention by now, by dates, you know, you have not examined the child still, but you know whether it's a term baby or a preterm baby. So then you know whether it is born by consanguineous or non-consanguineous marriage, it's a normal vaginal delivery or cesarean section. Then you know what is the reason why the baby is still here. Is the baby is for is he for postnatal care? Has he got some transition problem that was he admitted in the NICU, or whether he's here and how is he feeding? Adequacy, who's by history wise we have assumed that adequacy is there with no significant weight loss. So that's all what you need to know. What is he waiting for postnatal routine, postnatal care? I think that should be sufficient in the summary. Yeah. So now coming to general physical examination, the format is relatively okay. Whatever the format the Shravan has presented is fine. So only thing is I just wanted to emphasize here that you need to know the first thing is the appearance of the baby. So he has told us about posture, attitude. It may be a little difficult to do all this at the posture level. Probably you can do it at tone assessment level when you're doing the CNS examination of the baby. So probably I just want to know that the baby is alert, or what state the baby is in, what state of neurological illness, what state of neurological awakefulness is the baby. That's what I want to know. What is the stage of awakefulness? All of you know that the best time to examine the baby is 1 hour post feed or before the next feed. You know that 1 hour post feed is important. Also, we need to know some of the stages. There's something called as Pretschel stages or Breselton stages of newborn sleep or awakefulness. So we have to examine the baby on stage 3 Breselton or stage 3 of Pretschel staging, where the baby is just opening his eyes but he's not much moving his limbs and he's quiet and not crying. So that is the best stage to examine the baby. So if somebody asks you when is the best time to examine, so you say it is post feeds, 1 hour after feeds, and probably in stage 3 Breselton stage is when he's ideally to be examined. So that's all. See, we saw the baby on feeding, or we say the baby was in the universal flexion, or he was flexed attitude, or he was sleeping, or his eyes are open. That's all. You alert, active, feeding. I saw the baby alert, active, feeding. Or how is the general appearance? Suppose you know you want to know whether it's a sick child or is this a well baby. That's all. So probably I may not do all this at this level. So probably I will just say general appearance. And then I will straight away go to vitals. So the second thing what you're going to mention is the vitals. Third thing is anthropometry. And so this is how you're going to go. So vitals, whatever he has told is fine. So all of us know that in vitals, we are going to look at TABC. So temperature, airway, breathing, circulation. So in temperature, you know that normal newborn temperature. So you should know what is a normal newborn temperature. It is 36.5 to 37.5, and questions at this level they're going to ask you questions on hypothermia. So at least you should be knowing what are the degrees of hypothermia. So you should know what is cold stress, what is mild, moderate hypothermia, and what is severe hypothermia. So you know that less than 32 degrees, you know, is severe hypothermia. 35.9 is moderate hypothermia, and it is 36 to 36.5 is cold stress. So that's what you need to know about what is cold stress, what is mild, moderate hypothermia, and what is severe hypothermia. And how to measure the axillary temperature, you should be knowing it is by the thermometer, and you keep it vertically in the axilla, apex of the axilla, and you know that it is kept vertically and not horizontally, and you're going to complete it for 3 minutes. So that is this much you should be knowing at temperature level. In airway level, you're going to say it is stable. If you're able to say if it is open and stable, means if you're able to see chest rise, airway is stable, then you know you're going to look at respiration. So breathing, so you want to look at respiration. So you want to tell us about the respiratory rate. You want to know whether there are any increased work of breathing. So you want to know whether there are retractions, or whether there's grunting, or all of you know what is the normal respiratory rate of newborn. Normal respiratory rate is around 40 to 60. 40 to 60 is a normal respiratory rate. Then you need to know normal heart rate. So heart rate of the baby, all of you know it is ranging from 110 to 160. So less than 100, you know, bradycardia. Above 180, 160, you can say it is tachycardia. And then you know that you know about blood pressure. So you know blood pressure, usually we're going to measure by non-invasive method is how you're going to measure. Nobody expects you to measure blood pressure, but roughly you should know that it is half of normal adult blood pressure, that is 60 by 40 is normal blood pressure of neonates. And then you know that it's oscillometric pressure. But one thing, if you have a pulse oximeter, it's better to tell us about the pulse oximeter. And also you need to know how the capillary filling time. In circulation, we need three things. That is, one is the heart rate. Second is the capillary filling time. And third thing is, how are the pulses? So you're going to look at the central pulses, that is brachial, radial. And you are looking at posterior tibial pulse. And also looking at if posterior tibial pulse is felt. So femoral and posterior tibial pulses. In the central pulses, brachial and femoral, and peripheral pulses, radial and posterior tibial pulses you're going to know. And you know that in pulses, can you use it as a screening for congenital heart? You know that if you're not able to feel the pulses at the femoral, if you have a radiofemoral delay, it can be a screening for coarctation of aorta. And they will ask you how to do a capillary filling. Some of the tests they will ask you to perform. And one of the tests to perform is that they will ask you how to demonstrate capillary filling time. So I hope you know how to do a capillary filling time. How do you demonstrate capillary filling time is, you're going to stretch, keep your finger on the sternum, which is on the bony surface, and you're going to flush it. And you see that once you compress it, you see that it gets blanched, and then you see how fast it refills. So you know, less than 3 seconds you're going to say the capillary filling time. And of course that's about the vital. So you need to know about temperature, you need to tell us about the airway, whether stable or not, breathing, you want to know the respiratory rate, is there increased work of breathing, heart rate, you're going to say the heart rate, blood pressure, you're going to, if most likely, refilling time, and the peripheral. You're going to look at weight at this level, at anthropometry level, is that you're going to ask, how do we classify the newborn? How do we classify newborn? Now, classification of newborn is based on gestation, based on weight, and based on both weight and gestation. So you should be able to answer what is normal birth weight. So normal birth weight, as all of you all know, is 2.5 kgs. Anybody who's born less than 2.5 kgs is low birth weight. And how do we classify based on weight is, somebody who's less than 1 kg will be extremely low birth weight. 1 to 1.5 will be very low birth weight. And somebody who's like 1.5 to 2.5 is just low birth weight. Okay. And how do we classify based on gestation? Term gestation is defined as 37 completed weeks. So anybody who's born before 37 weeks is preterm. And in 37 weeks, you know that if he's born before 37 weeks, he's preterm. And how do we classify preterm further? Suppose he's born less than 28 weeks, he becomes an extreme preterm. So 28 to 32 weeks, he's very preterm. 32 to 34 weeks, he's moderate preterm. 34, 36, 6 bar 7, he's late preterm. So that's how we classify preterm. So you should know the classification of preterm babies with newborns based on gestation, based on weight, and based on weight and gestation. So you're going to look at the term baby, whether it's a preterm baby, and whether he's appropriate for gestation. So we're going to put him on the growth chart and see whether he's below the 10th centile, whether he's above the 90th centile, or is between 10th and 19th centile. So somebody whose birth weight for the age and sex is between the 10th and 9th and 90th centile, he is appropriate for gestational age. If he's below the 10th centile, he is small for gestational age. And if he's above the 90th centile, he is large for gestational age. Okay. And when he's if he's SGA, we need one more index. So normal people, we don't expect you to tell us the Pondal index. We want you the Pondal index only in small for gestation age babies, because we want to know whether he is symmetric IUGR or whether he is an asymmetric IUGR. So for that reason, we want to know the Pondal index. And you know, Pondal index is calculated by weight and grams and divided by length in centimeter cubed. So that gives you Pondal index. If a Pondal index is less than 2, you know he's an asymmetrical IUGR. If the Pondal index is more than 2, it could be normal or a symmetrical IUGR. Okay, that's the importance of anthropometry. So anthropometry, we expect you to know the normal birth weight. We know that it is about 2.5 kgs. Length, you know, it is 50 centimeters average, and head circumference is around 33 to 35 centimeters. And we also need to know the rate of gain of weight, length, and head circumference in the first 1 year of life. Most likely you're going to be asked the next question, what is the rate of weight gain of in weight? And as all of you know that we divided it in the first 3 months, next 3 months, the 1 year is divided into four segments. And you know, first 3 months, at least you should be knowing that weight by term babies will be growing around 30 grams per day. In the next 3 months, it is 20 grams per day. Next, you know, it is 15 grams per day, and then 12 grams per day. That's how you divide the weight gain in the first 1 year. Head circumference, 2 centimeters per month in the first 3 months, 1 centimeter, and then 0.5, 0.5 centimeters. So that's how you're going to, how the weight increases. Similarly, you shouldn't be knowing how the length increases in the first 1 year of life. At least you should be knowing. Second important thing, they can demonstrate. They will ask you to demonstrate how to measure head circumference. How do you measure the length? And how do you measure the weight? All of you know that weighing machine is the electronic weighing machine, which you're going to look. Length, you're going to measure by infantometer, and you're going to fix the head. And the other part, you're going to move and keep the feet against the other part, and then you're going to adjust the length. And then you're going to know head circumference is by cross tape method. And it's not the meeting edges, it is a cross tape method on the parietal area, and you're going to minus the overlapping segments. That's one of the reasons how they're going to ask you. And the other question at anthropometry level will be, to what is microcephaly, what is macrocephaly? So this is one thing which you're going to be looking at. So you know that less than 3 standard deviations of head circumference will be microcephaly, more than 2 standard deviations will be macrocephaly. So this would be the questions which are going to be expected at anthropometry level. Okay, so next let us go to the examination, which is head-to-toe examination. So head-to-toe examination, Shravan has written most of the things, but only thing is what we really require is we need not actually tell that this is not present. So that doesn't go well when you say that this is not present. It becomes very if it is obviously present, you're going to mention that this is present. But if you cannot say that caput or cephalomatoma not present, so then you're expecting cephalomata for everybody. No. So at this level, what I would suggest is, what is there? What is present? For example, he has said milia present, no dysmorphic features, eyes are normal, ears are normal. Like that, you can say, no, instead of saying they are not present, you can just say these structures are normal. And I've looked for this. They have to get an idea that you have looked for this, then that's more than enough. And you should mention some of the normal findings which you are going to see in a normal newborn. So that is the next question which you're going to be asked at this level. At this level, you're going to be asked of what are some of the normal newborn findings you're going to find out in head-to-toe examination. So that's what you're going to see in head-to-toe examination. So just to summarize whatever he has told, like head, what are we going to see in the head? So head, we are going to see any obvious swellings are there. And you know that the three head swellings which are required is, you know that the differences. So you should be knowing what are the at questions at this level could be, what is caput, what is cephalomatoma, and what is subgaleal hematoma, and how do you differentiate between the three? So all of you know that the way I would tell you to remember is that you look at what is the etiology to it, how it happens, how the swelling happens. That will help you to differentiate between these three swellings. So you know that caput is because of the head being at a particular station for a long time. And you know that it is collection of fluid in the loose areolar tissues of the scalp, and therefore it does not have any boundaries. You cannot fluctuate it, and it is present at birth. It disappears after second or third day. Whereas you see cephalomatoma, it is because of bleeding into the periosteal region, and therefore you can see you can note it only by end of 24 hours. It is going to persist for about 6 to 8 weeks, and because it is bounded into the subperiosteal area, it is bounded by margins, and it can be fluctuated. and it can be a cause for jaundice in the baby. And you know intervention to be done in cephalhematoma unless it is infected. And then you're going to follow up the baby and you know it takes around 6 to 8 weeks to disappear. Whereas subgill hematoma is the subepineurotic space bleed. And therefore it is again not, you know, it is not bounded by margins. It's a loose space. And usually it is be covering the mastoid and the mastoid area. You're going to have a large swelling and it is one of the cause for pallor and shock at birth. So these are the three common swellings which you're going to look at the head. And of course in head we also look at whether there is ridging, so you can see that there's overlapping of sutures. That's what you're going to look at. And of course the anterior and posterior fontanelle, you say whether it is present or not. And most important thing is in the fontanelle level, what you're going to look at is you want to know whether the fontanelle is, how to measure the fontanelle is another common question which is going to be asked, is how the fontanelles are going to be measured. All of you know it's rhomboid shape and you're not going to measure at the edges. You're not going to measure, it's going to be measured on the borders, midpoint of the borders. You're going to match and that's how you're going to measure the anterior fontanelle. It's not measuring the edges and you know it is 2.5 into 2.5 centimeters. And the common questions can be asked at this level is, when does the anterior fontanelle close? You usually say 16 to 18 months. Whereas posterior fontanelle can be open at birth, can be closed at birth, and you can see that by 6 to 8 weeks is usually closes. And the other question which can be asked at this point is, what are the causes of delayed closure of anterior fontanelle? What is the cause of delayed closure of anterior fontanelle? Yes, you need to measure the anterior fontanelle. So, and I told you how to measure is not by the edges, but it is by, and you also you need to know what are the causes of delayed closure of fontanelle. So this much you should be asking. Because of short of time, I'm not sure whether I could tell you all the answers of all this, but at least these are the questions which are going to be asked at the at each level, at when you examine the scalp. And then you're going to look at face mainly for any dysmorphic features, and you're going to look at some of the normal findings which you're going to find out, which I'll enumerate later. And you can look at eyes, and eyes we want to know whether there is cataract or not and whether there's a red reflex present. You are expected to see the red reflex. You can say red reflex, there is no cataract. Sometimes if there's obvious swelling like coloboma or anything is there, you can tell. Otherwise it is not required. And then if you look at ears, you want to know whether you should, sometimes you may ask what is low set ears. So you're going to see that if you're going to pass a line across the Frankfurt's plane, that means joining, if you're going to join a line from the medial canthus, the glabella, you're going to extend it across to the occipital protuberance, you're going to see that 1/3 of the ear is going to be above that. If the ear is below that line, you're going to say it is low set ears. So, and if there is any obvious, like for example, preauricular skin tag, or if there is a sinus, you're going to mention. Otherwise, nothing. Okay, nose. Of course, you're going to look at if any abnormal finding is there, you're going to say, otherwise no. Oral cavity, if there's any prenatal teeth, you're going to mention. Otherwise, you're not going to mention. And then skin, you're going to say, of course, vernix caseosa are present, lanigo, skin is normal. I just want you to enumerate some of the normal findings of newborn. So they will, what kind of question which I ask you in head to toe examination is normal newborn findings. What are some of the normal? So you can have some, you can enumerate some. Skin findings are normal. Some findings can be there on the face. Some findings can be there which are normal. So so what are the normal findings? I don't know whether I can share the screen. Probably I had a presentation to show you all again how, what are the normal newborn findings. So if you look at the skin characteristics, maybe the anthropometry, you know, overall observation, how the child movement, tone, you can make out. Head, mainly fontanelle, facial appearance for dysmorphic features. Eyes, mainly we are looking at cataract and red reflex. Mouth, we are looking at life-threatening anomalies. So some, like for example, cleft lip, cleft palate, cyanosis is there. When you look at the upper limbs, you want to know the number of digits, the palmar creases, which are important. If you have a simian palmar crease, you can see features of Downs. So then you look at chest, I told you respiratory rate. Then you, when we examine, we'll of course look at heart sounds, murmur, abdomen, whether it's distended, of course, liver and spleen. Then when we look at umbilicus, we need to know, tell us about what are the findings in umbilicus, which I'll tell you. Hips, pulses, genitalia, back. You have to always remember that you should not forget the back. This is just to tell you. And skin wise, we need to know the pallor, jaundice and plethora. So this is what we roughly do. But I just want to tell you about some of the normal skin findings and how do they look. You can see that there are small comedone-like lesions which are usually seen around the, you know, nose, on the face, so you can see it on the scalp, back. So these are small comedone newborn findings, which I told you some of the normal newborn findings you should be knowing quickly to enumerate in the exam. So this is about milia. Then you can see one of the small pustule-like lesion on a red background. Pustule-like lesion on a red background, which is called as erythema toxicum. And then something which has a pigmentation around it, and you can see some scaling around it. This is called as transient neonatal pustular melanosis. So transient neonatal pustular melanosis. Sometimes you can have neonatal acne, and of course Mongolian spots. You know, these are some of the normal newborn findings. Sometimes you can see in a premature child, you can see sometimes the veins, reticulated appearance of the veins under the skin, which you call as cutis marmorata. You can see some of the capillary hemangiomas, small capillary hemangiomas on the nape of the neck, on the eyelids, nose, scalp. So the lesions which disappear. So these are some of the, all these lesions will disappear. So you can see, but sometimes some, like if you see like your markers for Sturge-Weber syndrome, so those will not disappear. Whereas these things, this is called as nevus simplex, most of these rashes are going to disappear. One more change which I have not shown you is the Harlequin skin change, where half of the body will be pale, half of the body will be vascularized or pink. So that's called Harlequin skin change. So these are the, some of the common skin findings which you need to know is nevus simplex, or you can say stalk bites, and then you can see cutis marmorata, Mongolian spots, neonatal acne, transient neonatal pustular melanosis, erythema toxicum, milia. These are some of the common newborn skin findings which you can know. Apart from that, if you see oral cavity, you can have something called as bones nodules, prenatal teeth, and at the palate, you can see Epstein pearls. So these are some of the normal newborn findings, skin findings. Then when we look at scalp, I told you which are the differences last time. I told you of what is cephalhematoma, what is caput, and what is subgaleal hemorrhage, which I've already mentioned to you. Okay, fine. So this is I just wanted to show you because I already opened the screen. So this is something with umbilical granuloma, a small fleshy pink colored fleshy protrusion which you can see in the umbilicus. Sometimes it may be having a discharge with it. So when you can have a patent uracus, suppose the persistent discharge, one of the causes would be a patent uracus. And what is the treatment for umbilical granuloma is commonly asked in the exam. So you can see that you're going to cauterize it with rock salt, or you can say copper sulfate or silver nitrate. So you can use the cauterization you're going to do for umbilical granuloma. Okay, fine. So that's what I wanted to show you all in the normal newborn findings. So as I told you, so normal newborn findings, some skin findings are there, some oral cavity findings, that is prenatal teeth, you can have bones nodules, Epstein pearls, then you can have vaginal bleeding, some of the caput you can also say is a normal newborn finding. And then so when you enumerate some normal newborn findings, you have a list of normal newborn findings for you to examine, for you to answer the normal newborn findings at the head to toe level. Otherwise, most was told by Shravan about what you're going to routinely look for head to toe. Okay, so next, let us go to the systemic examination. Now, when we go to systemic examination, specifically, we are wanting you to tell us about each system, but more likely we are dealing with most of the other system, the examination is the same as what you do for routine examination of thing. But before going to systemic examination, we also need to tell you about gestational age assessment. So we expect you to do, we don't expect you to do the normal which we do in the NICU as the new Ballard scoring system, but at least the name you should know. What is the scoring system for, to distinguish whether it's a term or a preterm? So you say that it is, we require a norm, we see is the new Ballard scoring system. There are some other scoring system, but at least you need to know new Ballard scoring system, where we have some physical features and some neurological features. So there are six physical features, like you look at the eyes, you look at the ears, you look at the scalp, you look at breast nodule, you look at the genitalia, and then you you put a score for you calculate the score, and you pick up from particular score, you get the particular particular gestation. So that's how you're going to do. At least the name you need to know, but by look at the baby, you should be able to tell at least some few features. You should be knowing the differences between term and preterm. For example, if you see the scalp, you know that the preterm hair is, you know, fuzzy, woolly, whereas a term hair is long and silky. Then when we look at ear recoil, you know, the cartilage is not very well developed in preterm. Definitely there will be, if it is in a preterm baby, you know that the cartilage is not well formed, and therefore your not ear recoil is poor, whereas it's well recoil back in a term baby. And then when we look at breast nodule, you know that it is more than 5 millimeters, and you know it is pigmented, whereas in a preterm babies it is just a fine mark you can see. And then when we look at sole creases, you see that anterior two-thirds only you'll be seeing in preterm, whereas term entire sole you can have sole creases. Whereas genitalia, you know, the male genitalia, testis is descended or testis is not descended, and then you know that testis are well formed. And you know, preterm in a female, you know, clitoris is prominent or labia majora covering the labia minora. So based on this, you can make a difference between. So you should be ready for an answer of what is difference between term and preterm physically. If they say, how do you assess it? You have a score which we call as New Ballard scoring system. So that's how we are going to look at the scoring system. Otherwise, most of it which I have enumerated there, definitely don't forget the back. So back is for the sinuses, neural tube defect. So you want to look at a pit or a sinus at the back. You want to look at any, if there's an obvious swelling, which is a meningomyelocele or encephalocele. So you're going to look at the swellings at the back. You're going to look at sinuses, tuft of hair. Then you're going to look at the orifice, that is anal orifice. We want to know two things. One is we want to look at a screening test for DDH, that is development dysplasia of hip, and also to look at whether the talipes equinus varus is present, club feet. So we want to look at club feet examination. So if you are able to approximate your dorsum of your sole with the shin of your tibia, then most likely there is no talipes. That's how you roughly say that there is no talipes equinus varus. And of course, we have two maneuvers, at least the names you should be knowing. I think what I will do is I will try to make a video of all the examination findings to you so that it can be screened sometime, because it is difficult for me to demonstrate how to examine. So probably we'll just do all the examination findings once and then show it to you, so that how you can know how to do it. So what we at least you need to know, the how do we roughly tell whether there is a development dysplasia of the hip joint examination is Ottoloni and Barlow. So Ottoloni test and Barlow test, this much you should be knowing in the general physics. But coming to the systemic examination, so we are going to look at the cardiorespiratory system. What he says is, we are not looking at percussion and other things. We just straight away want to know about air entry. We want to know any abnormal sounds are present. That's all what we require in respiratory system. Normal vesicular breath sounds are present, and then you're going to look at air entry. That's all. An increased work of breathing is there or not. That's all we are worried in the respiratory system. Per abdomen system, we are just looking at umbilicus, healthy. If it's a fresh one, you can know that, all of you know there are two arteries and one vein, and you know whether it is, what are the signs of umbilical sepsis. You should be knowing that there's redness, tenderness, discharge, and whether there is any umbilical granuloma. If you have, you can say that is there. And then you're going to look at palpation, percussion. Of course, we don't usually do. You say bowel sounds are present, and you just say that whether I'm able to palpate the liver or the spleen. It is usually, you know, that you can't have a 2 centimeter liver, spleen may be just palpable, which is normal finding. So the other route examinations are almost the same. That means respiratory system, we just want you to know air entry and whether vesicular breath sounds are present. Whereas cardiovascular system, we just tell us about S1, S2 heart, and there are no murmurs. Sometimes you may have an innocent murmur. So they may ask you, what are the causes of innocent murmur? What are the characteristics of an innocent murmur is what they're going to ask you. And then parabdomen, it is only whether any organomegaly is present, and then you want to know if there is abdomen is distended, prominent veins are there, and if their umbilicus status, that's what we know, and the orifices, you're going to look at whether any hernial orifices, if there is any hernia is there, that's all. So these are only things which you're going to look at parabdomen examination. Only CNS we expect you to do a little in detail. So I'm just again going to tell you means what we need to do in CNS examination is the state of awakefulness. So how I, as I earlier told, that there are some physiological states, present stages, how the baby is awake. That means you want to look at whether baby's eyes are open, whether the baby is moving actively, and the baby is crying. These three factors will tell you which stage the baby is. As I told you, we examine the baby in stage three, where the baby's eyes are open, but he's not moving and he's not crying. So that's the ideal stage to say. So you're going to say that is the stage where he is. You can examine the tone of the baby, reflexes of the baby, and some primitive reflexes. Cranial nerves, some specific examinations we do to tell that, okay, this cranial nerve is there, this cranial nerve. So for example, if I want to know, there is some, many of them ask whether should we really examine cranial nerve. So we just tell you that you can have some specific clues you will be seeing in the baby, which will tell you that this cranial nerves are okay. For example, you say that, so higher mental function is not, you're just saying the activity of the baby and the stage at which the baby is. So baby's eyes are opening, eyes are open, baby is moving or not, and the baby is crying. So that is the Bresselton staging we want to know. Activity is active, alert, feeding well. That's how you're going to say. And then when we are going to look at cranial nerves, you say that the baby has a blink response. If the baby has a blink response, you know 2, 3, 4, 6 are okay. There is no obvious dystagmus or there is no obvious deviation. You know 2, 3, 4, 6 are okay. Okay. And suppose if you say that baby is 7, there is no deviation of angle of mouth. So you know 7 is also okay. Then if he has a startled response, you know 5 is okay. Hearing, suppose you know there's a startled response, you know here is okay. And suppose 8 is okay. Suppose you have said that the baby, I've seen the baby swallowing, sucking, and from the baby, so you know that the baby's 9, 10, 11 is also fine. So that's a rough assessment of cranial nerves in the newborn. And then you look at the tone examination. So that's what we want to know, tell you about tone and tell you about reflexes. So these are the two examinations we specifically need, we expect you to do in a newborn. So that means tone, yes. Now what he, Shravan, told in the beginning is like how to hold the baby, like for example ventral suspension, or hold the baby in prone position, pull to sit. So these are the ways of assessing the tone of the baby. These are ways we do something called as 180 degree exam. You're not expected to do it, but you can just say that if you, when you pull to sit, obviously, you know, momentarily he'll be able to hold his head straight. So, and the back will be rounded, you know, the baby will be able to hold his head for momentarily. And when you place the baby on prone position, on your hand, prone position, what's going to happen is able to bring his head to midline momentarily and then flex his limbs up and down. So that's what is, what you look at ventral suspension. When you put the baby on prone, what can happen when you pull to sit, what happens? That gives you a rough clue of what's happening to the tone of the baby. And when you actively move, when you actively move, you can see the resistance to your movement. So that, you know, is what you're going to, what you're looking at, the passive movement, passive resistance you're going to look. So whether it is a good tone or tone is less or increased tone, that's all we want you to know. And other way of assessment of tone is angles, measurement of angles. We have something called as popliteal angle, adductor angle, scarf sign, which will tell us about the tone of the baby. So which has some measurements, which have specific degrees of measurement, and you will know that the baby has increased tone or decreased tone. Probably in the video, I mean, I will just try to do all this and show you all how we can measure tone. So tone measurement is by active movements. You're already seeing the baby moving actively. You say the tone is good. He's flexed, he's in uniform flexion. If he's extended and even well passive movement, you see that there's a low tone, then you can say how you're going to measure tone. You can measure by angles. You can do it by 180 degree examination. Like you can say pull to sit, ventral suspension, you can make out what's happening, put him on prone position, see what's happening. So you can see the tone measurement like this. Reflexes, of course, we just want to tell you about the brachial reflex. We want to see about the radial, and then we want to know the knee jerk. That's all. We don't expect you to do any other thing. But the other important reflexes, the primitive reflexes, we want you to know how to demonstrate. And we also need to, for you to know about the onset, when it is well developed and when it disappears. So that's mainly these five reflexes you should be knowing. Now, what are the reflexes which we need to know in primitive reflexes? We need to know is rooting reflex, sucking reflex, grasp reflex, that is plantar grasp, palmar grasp, moros, asymmetric tonic neck reflex, placing, if you know placing, and crossed extensor reflex. So crossed extensor, placing, stepping, cross extensor. These are the normal newborn reflexes which you should know. And what you need to know in the exam, they may ask you sometimes, what is the importance of each of these reflexes, when they appear, when they disappear, and what is how to demonstrate some common reflexes. Common reflexes, especially moros, they may ask you to demonstrate. Rooting, they may ask you to demonstrate. They may ask you to demonstrate ATNR. So you should be knowing some common reflexes. As I told you, CNS, you have to tell us these headings. So how the baby is looking, general physical examination. Tell us about the tone. Tell us about the reflexes. Tell us about the primitive reflexes. And in primitive reflexes, tell us about rooting, sucking, plantar palmar grasp, tell us about moros reflex, and tell us about ATNR, placing, stepping, as well as crossed extensor. These are the common reflexes which you need to demonstrate. But I'll just give you a brief clue of how rooting is, when it starts, when it disappears. I'll just tell you for, and the questions associated which you're going to ask. So rooting reflex, you can see that you're going to do it by just stroking your fingers around the, you know, upper lip. You're going to just stroke. You can see that the baby is rooting, means he's searching for the breast. So he's going to come towards the side of stimulus. So all of you know that rooting reflex is because God has not given head control. Till head control develops, you'll have rooting reflex. So obviously, you know that rooting reflex is going to be present from 32 weeks. And it's fully developed by 36 weeks. It disappears when you get neck control. That is 3 to 4 months. It's going to disappear when you get neck control. That is 3 to 4 months. Coming to the next reflex, that is palmar and plantar grasp. So palmar grasp is, you just have to give your little finger stroke across the ulnar side of your palm. So you'll see that the baby is holding the hand. And when you just try to lift it, he has a grip. You can see that there's a stiffening of his muscles in the forearm. You can see that he's trying to come along with the grip. So that you know that the palmar grasp, the onset is around 28 weeks, fully developed by 32 weeks. It disappears by 2 to 3 months. So palmar grasp, onset is 28 weeks, fully developed by 32 weeks, and disappears by 2 to 3 months. Rooting reflex, 32 weeks onset, fully developed by 36 weeks, disappears by 3 to 4 months. Moros reflex appears by 28 to 32 weeks, fully developed by term, that is 37 weeks, and disappears by 4 months. With Moros reflex, ATNR, it is onset around 35 weeks, fully developed by 1 month of age, and then you know disappears when 3 to 5 months. All of you know that ATNR is when you try to turn the baby to one side, the face to one side, you know that the limbs on that side get extended, whereas the other side gets flexed. Okay, so that is ATNR. That prevents the baby from rolling over. So obviously, it's going to disappear when the baby can roll over, that is by 4 to 6 months. So that's when your ATNR will disappear. Whereas Moros reflex, all of you should be knowing how to, this is the commonest question which has been asked in exam about Moros reflex. So you hold the baby on your extended arm, on the head should be held on your palm, and you slightly drop the baby at 45 degrees, slightly drop the baby, you can see what's going to happen. So there are two phases of Moros reflex. So one is phase one and the second is phase two. Phase one Moro, you just, how do you remember is, you just remember the joints. So you remember the shoulder joint, elbow joint, and wrist joint. So shoulder joint, there is abduction, abduction of the shoulder joint, extension of the elbow joint, opening up of your wrists. Okay, similarly, the next phase is phase two is adduction, flexion, and cry. So the baby is going to cry. So that's how you're going to explain the phase one Moro is there even in preterm, whereas in preterm babies, phase two is not there. So Moro's reflex means, you know that the cerebral, suppose if there is baby's neurological status is not good, there is a cerebral dysfunction, Moro's reflex will be incomplete. So for example, your birth asphyxia baby, say Moro's reflex will be incomplete. So you're going to say it is a measure of cerebral function. And suppose the other question is when it is going to disappear. All of you know it's going to be disappeared by 4 to 6 months. Beyond 6 months, if you see Moro's, or beyond 6 months, if you see ATNR, or beyond 6 months, if you see that the baby has, before beyond 2 months, if you see baby has kept his wrist, thumb adapted to the palm, which you call as Crutchley's sign, these are early markers of cerebral palsy. So if you see that persistent ATNR, persistent Moro's are early markers of CP. So they're going to be early markers of CP. And then you're going to say, the other question which is going to be asked in Moro's reflex is, what about asymmetrical Moro's? Suppose you see Moro's reflex, you see that the response is only on one side. You can see that it could be because of a brachial plexus palsy, or it could be a fracture clavicle. So it could be Erb's palsy or Klumpke's palsy. You see that there could be a, in a brachial plexus palsy or a fracture clavicle, you see only on one side, and it's not a complete Moro. So these are some of the questions which can be asked at reflexes. So in reflexes, you should be knowing some of the reflexes. That is, I told you, rooting, sucking, palma, plantar, Moro, asymmetrical tonic neck reflex. Crossed extensor reflex is when you try to, you keep one limb extended by holding the knee at one side. You stroke the sole of one side. You see that the opposite limb flexes. It's called as crossed extensor reflex. So what we can demonstrate these signs on examination and send it across to you. But in examination wise, we expect you to do the newborn reflexes. Tell us how to assess the tone of the baby, and then tell us about some common reflexes as what going to be asked for you in the exam. And finally, when we come to diagnosis of the child, so when you come to the final statement of diagnosis, we definitely want to, we don't tell if the baby found to be normal. We say we want to assume that he's a day 3 old baby. Term, is he term or is he appropriate for gestation age? Because you would have classified him. Once you would have told from gestation, you would have got an idea whether it's a term or preterm. So you will tell is a term or preterm, and of course you have done an assessment. You can do is he looks term, preterm. So you will come to idea whether it's term or preterm. So you're going to put as term, preterm. Then you're going to plot him on the graph and see whether he's appropriate for gestational age or he's small for gestational age. You have to classify him appropriate or small for gestational age. And then you're going to look at what problem he's there for. So for example, he's for routine postnatal care. He's for routine postnatal care, or you just say that he has newborn jaundice. So you can say neonatal hyperbilirubinemia, secondary to what? So secondary to what? Suppose you have weight loss, dehydration, you see, you feel it is breast milk, breastfeeding jaundice, you say it is probably dehydration and breastfeeding jaundice. Suppose you have RH setup, it could be RH isoimmunization, or there is an ABO setup, or there is a cephalhematoma which is causing the jaundice. So that's why you're going to tell that this was there. Suppose there is a history of birth asphyxia, so you say that there's birth asphyxia. Suppose baby had some respiratory problem, you can put that in the diagnosis. So you are going to tell, and suppose if there's obvious finding, so obvious finding, for example, you see that dysmorphic features are there, obvious newborn findings which you have noted, you can write that also in the diagnosis. So this, so consanguinity also, you can bring it out, talk about the feeding of the baby, and significant, any particular significant family history, you can also tell in that conclusion of your diagnosis. So that's in the conclusion, and any specific findings which you find that it's abnormal, you're going to include that also in the diagnosis. Otherwise, you should mention it is a term, whether it's appropriate for gestational age, and what is the reason why he's here. So what he's for postnatal day, he's immunized, he's appropriate for gestation age, no obvious dysmorphic features. All those important points should be there in your diagnosis. And what are some of the other questions which you can be asked at the end of your discussion is, suppose you say preterm, they're going to ask you about, you enumerate some few complications of preterm. What are some of the questions or some of the common conditions which you see in preterm specifically? You may ask a question. Secondly, if you present, say, for example, you say it's a small for gestational age baby. So they're going to tell us, can you give us some features of IUGR babies? What are some of the problems with the IUGR babies encounter? So you're going to tell us about IUGR babies. So then you can be asked about, I told you, if you mention the problem the baby had, they may ask you a little bit in detail. For example, birth asphyxia, they may ask you about birth asphyxia. They may ask you about, if you say complication was jaundice, they may ask you in detail about jaundice. And then if the question was on some respiratory disorder, like for example, TTNB, they may ask you what are the causes of respiratory distress in newborn. So if you mention that problem, you're going to be carried out in that domain. So you're going to be asked questions in that particular domain. So mainly all of you should be knowing what are the definite questions which are going to be asked in the first trimester, second trimester, third trimester. What are the possible questions which are going to be asked, which I told you, you enumerate it and write it down somewhere. And second thing is, what are the normal things? What are normal newborn findings? Basic things like, for example, how to measure head circumference, weight, length, how to classify newborn, what are common newborn problems, how do you normally examine some of the reflexes, what is normal? What you first identify what is normal and some common problems, neonatal conditions is what going. If you answer whatever these questions which have been highlighted, I think newborn will be very easy for you to score in the exam. And probably I would also like to demonstrate in a video and probably send it across so that you can play it sometime and see how a normal newborn examination is done.
Thank you so much, sir. Shravan, thank you so much.